Good evening, and welcome to tonight's meeting of INFORUM, a division of the Commonwealth Club by and for people in their 20s and 30s, with the mission to inspire debate on civic issues. You can find us online at commonwealthclub.org/INFORUM. I'm Michael Copeland, and this evening's moderator. Tonight, we are here to discuss venture capital. Banks aren't lending, and private equity is tight, but Silicon Valley keeps churning along. That doesn't mean the money is easy to come by. More startups are bootstrapping. Those in need of money are knocking on a lot more doors. And if your company is lucky enough to get funding, you had better hit certain milestones. Let's talk to some prominent Silicon Valley VCs and get the scoop on what types of companies they are investing in, how they are investing, what sectors are favored over others, and why. Tonight we host Mike Buckley, a managing director of Intel Capital. Previously, he was a partner and vice president at Orca Capital Corporation. We have Dixon Dahl, the co-founder and general partner of DCM. He was also the most recent chairman of the U.S. National Venture Capital Association and served on the executive committee. There's Jennifer Fonstad, the managing director of Draper, Fisher, Jurvetson. She is also on the investment committees for DFJ's Vina Capital, Tamara Fishman, and DFJ's partner funds in Israel, Vietnam, and China. Next to her, we have David Tennenhouse, Ph.D., a partner of New Venture Partners. He is a member of the Association for Commuting Machinery and a fellow of the IEEE. And finally, Rory ODriscoll, a managing director of Scale Venture Partners. He currently sits on the boards of Arena, Exact Target, Hubspan, Innovian, Jaspersoft, and several other companies. Thank you all. So I thought venture capital was dead. There's all this talk, and there's been talk for a while now, how the model is broken. And maybe, Dixon, you can tell us why or why not, why that isn't the case.
Don't think the model is broken. It's in need of change. Our industry has been characterized by change just as it always has been since it started roughly 35, 40 years ago. And the only thing that that I can say now is a time when the world is changing, and if venture capital partnerships are not keeping up with the change, then they have a problem.
Jennifer, what are some of the changes you see within the VC industry, and how is that affecting your decisions in terms of investment, and you know, what should entrepreneurs be aware of?
Well, I think that's a good question. I think what we, DFJ, is very focused on early stage investing, and one of the things we focus on is disruptive innovation. And despite what happens in the public markets and the credit markets, we see the engine of innovation continuing to chug along. In fact, there's been quite a lot of work done to demonstrate that even in the most depressed times and during the height of the Depression, we've had a number of company formations which form the basis for the Fortune 100 and Fortune 500 today. So we take a very antithetical approach to the current markets and are investing quite aggressively. We think this is an excellent time to be investing. When you speak about changes in the industry, I think some of the changes that we're seeing is that some of the funds that have typically been what I'll characterize as more followers into categories, and so some of the more obvious examples would be ones like some of the retail internet companies in the late 90s. Funds that were involved in a lot of those types of opportunities are going to have trouble raising new capital. And it may not be obvious to entrepreneurs. So they will certainly have their sign on the door, and they'll never tell you that they're out of money, but they won't be able to invest new capital. And so one of the challenges, I think, for entrepreneurs today is to identify which funds are investing, which groups have capital to invest, and truly are open for business.
Rory, I know you guys have recently raised a fund, so you've got some money to invest, and you're busy doing it. Maybe you can explain how scale, what you guys are focused on, and you particularly, what areas you're looking at these days that are interesting.
Sure, and I think, you know, first of all, at a very high level, I don't think our strategy has changed all that much. I mean, a lot's gone on in the economic environment in the last 12 months, but I think a big macro point I'd like to make is it actually doesn't impact all that much the kind of deals you want to invest in as a venture investor. I mean, there's been this huge cyclical disruption, but we're in the business of investing in kind of secular disruptions that can frankly withstand the vicissitudes of, you know, the market going up, the market going down. So I'd say the kind of deals we want to invest in actually hasn't changed all that much. IT departments are still buying new technology to get more efficient. Consumers are still looking at new things on the internet. So not much has changed in terms of the types of deal. I think what's interesting and what has changed, frankly, is the terms and the business dynamics and the valuations around how you make those investments. I mean, you mentioned Exact Target. It's the most recent deal I did earlier on this year. And I think the interesting point about that, and my guess is Dixon will talk about this whole subject of exits later, is that was a company that actually planned to do an IPO earlier this year and ultimately decided, given the tough market conditions, that they'd prefer to take private capital from ourselves and a couple of other large firms and just keep on building their company as a privately held entity. And I think a great decision for them, frankly, a great opportunity for us. It's not an opportunity that would have existed 2 years ago, because the public investors, the Fidelities, the T. Rowe Prices would have done that deal. But in this market, it's a great opportunity to do that kind of investment.
That gets to a question of who really should be taking venture capital. I mean, if you're an entrepreneur and you're thinking about starting a company, what kinds of companies really need to think about how much money they want to take at the beginning, and really if that's a good idea? And maybe, Mike, you can launch into that.
Yeah, I mean, just to kind of wrap on the other point, I mean, I think I totally agree that you still are, conceptually, you're still investing in innovation, and good ideas don't stop when, you know, the financial economy is in a downturn. So, you know, we too are trying to be relatively aggressive through this downturn. We're in the unenviable position, of not having a fund, and so we don't have to go through that process of re-raising funds periodically. To the point of, you know, what types of companies or entrepreneurs should raise money, I mean, you want to make sure if you're going to take in venture capital that that there is potential for significant scale, because venture capitalists are typically investing kind of a minimum size of money, and they're seeking potentially high, really high returns. And so the potential for a high return has to be there. The entrepreneur has to have the goal of building a substantial company, either to be acquired or to go public, but ultimately to be able to stand alone and be significant in size. So, you know, if that's not a goal, or if you're in it for a short term and you think it's a quick sale to Yahoo or whatever, although those are less common, now.
Yahoo?
Or whatever, you know, whatever company. You know, that really isn't the model for VCs. I mean, sometimes it happens, and it's not the worst thing that ever happens to a VC, but really you're looking for potentials, high potential return, and companies that get that are really strong businesses, stand alone, and don't require a bunch of partners.
I mean, there's a perception, and a lot of it is part of the media's kind of writes about this all the time, but that you can essentially start a company for the change you have in your pocket these days. And maybe that just means an internet-based company, but where does that sort of logic fall down? If I can start a company using open source software and you know, Google AdSense, at what point do I actually really need your help and your money and your expertise to scale?
It depends on how big you want it to be.
Yeah.
Very big.
Absolutely.
It also depends on the window that is available to your marketplace. So some markets are rapidly evolving, rapidly changing, and new capital can really accelerate your place in that marketplace. But if it's a slow-moving industry that doesn't change that dramatically that quickly, you have a lot more time, and additional capital may help, but it may not actually propel you into that dominant position.
And it also might not be attractive to a VC who's looking for superior returns.
Concur with all that, and what it points out is, frankly, how foolish the original statement is. And it gets said a lot, but it's obviously rubbish when you think about it. What we just said was, if you're a mediocre business growing slowly, you should not take our money. That really means we prefer not to give it to you.
I disagree with that. Yeah. So well, it doesn't necessarily imply it's a mediocre business. It's a different kind of business. It may be a great business for a sole proprietor.
Yes,
or even a
I mean, if you
team,
want to define it as a small, slow-growth business.
It's not necessarily mediocre at all, but could be quite lucrative. It's just not necessarily.
Yes, it's not a venture-backed business that can become a big business. But the point is, even the interesting point is that people say this about, you know, how internet companies can get started, and many of them have been. But what's very noticeable is, as some of my colleagues said earlier, once they try and scale,
especially in a fast-moving market, you need the money. And, you know, Google took cash, Facebook took lots of cash.
And it's still taking cash.
And it's still taking cash. And why? They're growing hyper-fast. And at some level, if you've got a really exciting deal, even if you are cash flow positive, you want to be able to lean into the opportunity. You want to be able to hire a senior exec team. And you can't say to them, well, we live hand-to-mouth, and, you know, we got $1 million of EBITDA, we're growing nicely, so take a chance. It's much more attractive to say, we've raised $15 million, we're growing a big business, and the good news is, if we have a down quarter next quarter, you won't have to skip your paycheck.
$1 million of EBITDA, just for those listening in, our earnings before
let's go with
and appreciation and
let's go with cash flow.
A couple other things.
Cash in versus cash out.
Yes. Thank you.
The only thing that
David, on this panel, you're something of an outlier in that you guys do corporate spin-outs, meaning you find these gems within, maybe gems or orphaned ideas within companies, take them out and take them private. They might be private already for that matter, but and make a go of it. Can you explain, is now a good time for a corporate spin-outs? You would sort of think logically that maybe it is.
I guess I'd say it's always a good time for corporate spin-outs. and in terms of the relative timing, probably, you know, corporations are looking at cutting a few more things now, so perhaps we get to see more projects. But I'm not sure the actual density of good opportunities is necessarily higher. What I'd say is that, you know, if you kind of look at our business, I look at it from the perspective of a former director of research. So you have a bunch of projects in a research environment. To be honest, most of them won't reach their technical goals. They're never really complete failures. You always learn something, but most of them don't reach their technical goals. The tragedy is that the ones that reach their technical goals, most of them don't, you can't figure out a good business model for them. So then of the ones that get through those two filters, and these are the gems, these are the jewels, most of them won't be big enough soon enough. And that's, I think, there are all sorts of reasons why corporations may spin off a technology, but it usually boils down to, gee, this thing is going to only do a few million dollars business in its first few years, and, you know, if we work at it, we can ramp it to $100 million in 5 years. That's a great VC deal, but for the corporate, they want something that's going to move the needle, so it's got to be $1 billion in the next couple years.
Right.
And so at the end of the day, if it really was $1 billion, they'd change their strategy. But since it isn't, they tend to shelve it. And I call that stranded research. So the great opportunity here is to take these things, move them into an environment where they can build to be big enough to be interesting, and then perhaps they'll be acquired by a company who wants to invest further and build them from $100 million to a billion.
Are there signs that those of us who work in a larger company of, you know, my research project is something that's maybe ripe for something like this, either in a positive way or a negative way?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a variety of signs. One is, you know, you've got these great results, but the company, the business unit typically in the company is just not willing to take it downstream. So it's at this point where it's when they tell you, could you keep it in the labs for a little while longer, that you really know, okay, it's time to do something, because as people mentioned, technology has windows. And what you don't want to do is miss that window of opportunity to move with it. So if you believe it's in that window, you've got to run. Now, there are some other ingredients. I look for, like most folks, great technology, great team, right? In our case, it's got to be somebody, a team that really wants to voice stuff on the world. But I think additionally, you've got to have a great sponsor within the company. In other words, is there somebody who's not leaving, who's an executive sponsor within the company, who's staying in the company, who really sees the value to the company of having this thing have an independent life, getting this technology out there because the company in the future might want to be a customer, it might want to be a supplier to this company, it might want to be a fellow traveler to sell with or whatever. You need that sponsor to help sort of give birth to the spinoff.
Now, you mentioned you want to take this company to the world, and Dixon, you guys opened an office in Japan. Jennifer, you're opening one in Japan. I know Intel Capital invests all over the world. Let's talk about Japan and Asia for a second, Dixon and Jennifer. Why that part of the world, and what kinds of companies are being formed there, and why are you so focused on it?
In the history of DCM, which was organized in 1996, the very first deal that we did, and how I actually met my co-founding partner, David Chow, who is ethnically Chinese, but he was born and raised in Japan. It was actually an investment in a company in Japan. It was the world's first mobile virtual network operator. And I think that the very specific reason that DCM has chosen a strategy, we focus on three of the world's most important economies. We do the U.S., China, and Japan. And it's not just because, you know, all the best deals are in those markets. It's because the volume of trade and the activity and the biz dev, you know, opportunities and the, frankly, the exit environment, as challenged as it is here domestically, we are finding that the investors in both Japan and China have, you know, they have plenty of cash, and this is where the economic growth is. It's well known that, at least based on our experience, that the Chinese economy has responded very, very quickly to the Chinese government's stimulus, which was put into effect very recently, very targeted stimulus. So the market there has, as one of my friends described, it's last in and first out in the whole recessionary situation. So we just think that the growth, the need to have the ability to open offices, to hire engineers and development teams in China, for example, as well as in India and some of these other countries, that's a critical factor in order to keep your capital intensivity within reasonable bounds. So I'll stop there and we can come back.
What happened to the notion of investing, you know, no farther than a bike ride from your office?
That's what I wanted to address,
which is, but it's an important concept in some respects, which is, and this is one of the biggest challenges that the venture industry struggled with in the late 90s and is now learning today, which is that the companies we invest in and are globally located and global players. So they may be based in anywhere in the world, and they may sell anywhere in the world. But the venture business is fundamentally a local business. It is, as Michael said, typically venture capitalists don't like to invest too far from where they live. And it's not just because they want to get home for dinner. It's because it's important to be able to have that relationship and that dialogue on a fairly frequent basis between the entrepreneur and their investor on all sorts of issues, strategic, hiring, all of which are hyper-local businesses. But the entrepreneurs need access to those global markets. They need access to those global customers. And so what you're seeing today, and one of the trends that you're seeing in the venture business, is how do you provide local support and global access? And models like DCM and DFJ have partner funds located in these regions, and we're speaking specifically about Asia, but that could be anywhere in the world. And we have partner funds, as Michael mentioned, all over the world, Asia being a particularly interesting one because of the growth rate, because of the high number of a domestic population, and because of this fundamental shift with this emerging economy. And emerging middle class.
Jennifer, I hate to interrupt, but we do not have a partner fund in Asia. We operate as a single fund that operates all over the geographies, and we meet every week as one partnership, one fund, one firm.
But fair enough.
That's how we do the touch.
Everybody has their challenges with how they do it.
I agree with the points that you make, though.
You guys go battle about your offices after this. Mike, Intel Capital invests all over the world and always has. And as a corporate venture arm, you guys have, as you mentioned or alluded to, you guys don't have to raise a fund. You get your sort of investment dollars from Intel. But you guys are all over the world sort of trying to sell more chips, I guess, by way of investment. But for you, when you're looking at companies, how important is it that they have a global perspective? If I'm a startup in Palo Alto or Chicago or, you know, Saigon, do I need to be global from day one?
I mean, I really think it depends on the company. I mean, I think more and more all companies need to be able to think globally. I don't feel strongly about forcing. I think maybe in contrast to Dixon, I don't feel strongly about forcing that right up front. You know, we have a global brand, we have a global presence in terms of Intel Capital. You know, with people on the ground in China and India and. We did deals last year in our history in 64 different countries. Over half of our dollars are invested outside the U.S., and half of our people are actually outside the U.S. from Intel Capital. So I think I totally agree with the local presence to help those companies, and then also to structure the deals appropriate for those companies that are based in the countries. I mean, so that's, you're competing against other local investors. There's local tradition, local language, you know, all those things really matter in trying to build a company. But we think we bring the global brand and the global presence that helps them, you know, gain that global perspective and then expand where appropriate globally too.
Well, let's shift gears a little bit and get to maybe what we're all looking for is where are you guys putting your money? What company can I come up with tomorrow and knock on your door that you're going to be excited about? Rory, what areas are you really focused on these days that show opportunity?
And again, you know, it's dull and boring. Much the same stuff as we've been focused on. I mean, I think that trends in finance change fast, and trends in technology change at a pretty steady pace. I agree with what Jennifer said earlier. It's nothing that we see indicates that the level of innovation has changed positively in 98, or negatively in 01, positively in 04, or negatively in 09, just because the NASDAQ went down. I mean, the electrons don't know the NASDAQ went down all that well. So we continue to do much the same stuff. I abhor a little bit the hot or not concept. In a lot of these panels, you get into the what's hot, what's not right now. And I would say to folks, come and plan to raise a business. The venture industry can be quite lemming-like. We're all guilty of it. Some sector comes hot and we all, oh my gosh, I wish I'd done that deal, which pretty quickly translates into I'd do a deal something like that. And pretty soon you have 10 or 11 deals funded that all look the same, sound the same, act the same. So we're very prone to fashion trends in the venture industry. And I often find a mistake that entrepreneurs make is to try and follow the fashion trend. I mean, be true to whatever opportunity you're pursuing.
You know, interestingly, I characterize it slightly differently.
I'm not surprised.
we have a tremendous amount of deal flow globally that comes in from all over. And what we often find is this clustering effect where you may spontaneously see deals that are very similar in six or seven deals covering one category. And it emerges less because people are lemmings and more because you actually have independent groups of people around the country and around the world who've identified a problem and have developed an approach for trying to solve that problem.
I actually agree with that statement because, and I think it actually makes total intuitive sense because it's an outgrowth of what we call the why now question. In almost any technology deal in particular, one of the questions you always ask yourself is, why is this happening now? And when you step back, what you generally realize is there's a couple of trends in technology that made something that was cost prohibitive, say, 3-4 years ago. Suddenly, the stars align, and more importantly, the economics align, and this particular problem can now be solved. So I absolutely agree with that statement. I think, for example, I think now some of the stuff that's really interesting in cloud computing, when you try and be objective about it, you suddenly realize it's about cost of broadband and broadband's access speeds. So that's internet access speeds. It's about storage costs that suddenly make a whole bunch of things that were uneconomic 3 years ago suddenly finally work and make the math work right. So I do agree with that.
And one of the ironies about the clean energy movement in particular is a lot of folks think it's all because Al Gore started it. First he started the internet and then he started clean energy.
You got to hand it to the guy.
But in fact, a lot of the innovation that we're seeing in clean energy is due to significant advances in manufacturing capabilities and semiconductor capabilities and even being able to manipulate materials in new and different ways.
Are you sure we're really
drive that?
Are you sure we're really seeing improvements?
Good question.
I'm seeing a lot of questions.
Yeah, I haven't.
But you're only looking at what's coming out of corporations. You're not working with the entrepreneurs.
No, I'm watching what other people are funding, and we're saying, why are they doing that?
Well, David, what's a recent deal you guys have done, and why was it so amazingly smart?
Ask you that in 5 years, right?
Yeah. A recent deal we've done that I really love is. We spun the complete MRAM technology, the MRAM business unit, essentially, out of Freescale. MRAM's magnetoresistive memory, so it's like random access memory DRAM, and except that the bits remain in the memory, much like they do with flash memory when you turn the power off.
MRAM's in your computer, right?
NRAM is not today in most computers. It's a relative, in terms of, this is in fact, the only group that's managed to productize it, has it on the market. And it's a technology that you would be familiar with that one. You should be.
DFJ invested as well.
Yeah, DFJ's in there. We like to syndicate. And that would have been, when you asked one of your earlier questions, one of my comments would have been change in syndication importance in terms of how people are behaving.
So, but MROM is a disruptive technology. It's a technology that we as consumers or business consumers are all waiting for, or what problem is it solving?
I think it's a technology that, hopefully, to be honest, initially will flow into a lot of devices without even noticing. Right? I don't think people are going to go buy something and say, whoa, it's got MROM in it. Yeah. In fact, we think that it's extremely compelling, though, to the people that design a lot of these embedded devices. There are reasons why it has semiconductor processing efficiencies, so it's much easier. If you want to build a chip that has both this non-volatile storage and logic, today the way you do that is you add flash to the logic process, and it just makes it a lot harder to build the chips. I won't go into all the technical details, but you end up adding a lot of steps, and guess what? The logic ends up not as good. So you end up with a product that's totally compromised.
So MROM solves
this technology problem. Allows you to add that non-volatile memory without compromising the logic part, the processor and everything else.
We're getting into engineering weeds a little bit.
Great stuff. Now, you asked about why was that such a brilliant deal. It's that the immense head start. Right? Freescale had spent, and before them, Motorola. So this technology had its roots in Motorola. There's been just many, many years of investment in the research leading up to this technology. This team had managed to get it to product, so that also says you had a team that is incredibly dedicated to foisting their technology on the world. It's not easy to take something from lab to fab and all the way through and get it yielding and full manufacturability and reliable and robust. So you have an incredible team, many, many years of technology development. You spin it out, now you add sort of entrepreneurial capability, which we're mixing in. And I think it's a great opportunity.
Jennifer, I'll ask you this question a different way. When you get a pitch from an entrepreneur these days, what are sort of the kind of hot button themes or, kind of words and titles of the day that, you get deeply suspicious of? Like if I came in and said I have a clean tech nano, cloud computing object that will save the world.
Yeah,
would you bite on that?
So there's certainly a lot of folks who are pursuing ideas because of something like the stimulus plan, who come in with the expectation that they're going to garner a lot of stimulus dollars. You've seen that. I see that in the clean energy space, broadly speaking. We've seen that broadly in also a little bit in the healthcare space because there's a significant amount of stimulus dollars heading into the healthcare category, and so. Folks are identifying and relying on that to some extent. Anytime that an entrepreneur is waiting for Godot, just sitting out there with the expectation that money will come from other sources, it's always a challenge. So what we focus on and what we're looking for are areas, as we talked about, which are disruptive. And so some of the categories that we are excited about are in those three areas, clean tech, personalized medicine, and the third I didn't mention yet, which is in the mobile application space. But those are all sort of broad categories. So what does that mean? And let me talk about the third one since we haven't talked about that a little bit. So mobile applications are exploding. iPhone has really opened up the opportunity for both small companies, entrepreneurs to get hit the big time very quickly with a hit game or some hit application, and we're seeing tremendous growth. And so when we have an entrepreneur that comes in, one of the challenges that we're looking at and says, we look at with these companies is how big can it be? So you may have the average life cycle for a hit game on the iPhone today is 90 days. We have a company called Flurry, which is a mobile analytics platform, which is now uploaded on over 42 million phones. And they literally track every click. And they can tell you what the life cycle is of every single game that they're embedded in. And so when we see an entrepreneur that comes in, we're trying to understand, is this a hit-driven business, or is this a sustainable opportunity where they can build a relationship with the customer that is ongoing and interactive, and they can build a business model around that is compelling.
So that's interesting. You guys invested in the analytics company that monitors these iPhone game applications, and not the game companies. the game companies come next? Is
So it depends. So we have invested in some game companies, but it has to be more than, like I said, a hit-driven.
It's the picks and the shovels.
Right. So you want it, so the beauty of the analytics business and Flurry is just flourishing. I mean, it's really taking off because it is so simple to use, and it's so critical for application developers today to be able to understand how are the users using it. How are the users, you know, do they care about that feature? And then later they'll think, well, this game is dying off. I see it's dying off. How do I upsell my next game to my existing user base? And an analytics platform like Flurry can enable them to do that.
It actually gets back to the discussion much earlier on about deals that are, I won't say suitable for venture, but deals that venture folks like. It is more comfortable. I mean, taking that as an example, it's more easy to contemplate how the analytics company can win and than it is to contemplate which of the games are going to win. Content is just hard to do. We've done some content deals. We've done well in some of them. We've done not so well in some of them. It's clearly not random. There are clearly people very good at it. But it's just a tough business for a venture investor to identify who is going to be good at a specific content.
I'd like to just add that I think venture capitalists, by and large, don't like a hits business any more than they like to invest in movies because you're not in control of your own destiny, and we're control freaks by nature. So, but you just can't. You're talking about the volatility of a game that comes along, and then it dies an instant death after people get bored with it. And that's very different than building a company that has a bunch of really, really good creators where you have confidence when you sign up to back them that they'll be able to come up with. Not only one game, but high likelihood of a series of games that can build on each other.
I also generalize beyond the mobile applications because I think there's this very dumb, obvious thing going on, which only happens about every 20 years, which is removing platforms.
From what?
You know,
to
we
what?
Went mainframe to mini. We went mini PC, and now everything's moving handheld. And that opens up a ton of opportunities in the application space. And we sort of know this, you know, these transitions happen. We know that there's a lot of change that happens in these transitions. So the network infrastructure is changing as a result of that, so it creates all sorts of infrastructure opportunities around that. The, you know, essentially, the analytics are effectively part of the OS of this environment, you know, for handhelds. People, you know, somebody... Please give me a docking station for this, and then I can just get off my... You know what I use my laptop for today? The only thing I used it for is to charge my iPhone. I need my... carry around my laptop so I can charge my iPhone.
Well, it took us actually... Jennifer, you were the first to mention the iPhone. It took us a half an hour to get there, which I was surprised. But, you know, I talked to some folks here in Silicon Valley who think the iPhone and the Apple platform is kind of running away with it already. Is it, you know... Mike, you do consumer internet, and that's all going to mobile, but... where are we in this phase of this next shift? Jennifer?
You want me to answer? Okay. So going back to Flurry, I just saw some data today, for example, they were talking about, and certainly they have iPhone's biggest competitor today is the iTouch. So you do have an interesting dynamic within Apple between the iPhone and the iTouch. But we're also seeing stability around Android, which is about 22% of the market and has held steady.
That's Google's open source platform.
Correct.
For mobile.
So it is looking like that may be a two, or if you count the iTouch, a three-horse race today. And I wouldn't rule out Google as a competitor in driving that. And frankly, you have an environment which is exploding. You will still see significant growth opportunity for Google in this environment.
I mean, I, to your question about where are we in this transition, I mean, we're right at the beginning. I mean, it's not even started, I think. I mean, we all have them. We're all, you know, using this kind of rudimentary kind of usage model, and the iPhone's at the very front edge of innovation and driving the usage models. But, you know, I think there'll absolutely be other compelling OSs and browsers or whatever you want to call them, however they evolve. And I think there's a huge amount of innovations yet to happen. When we were talking about companies that maybe aren't suited for venture investing, you know, iPhone application companies were exactly what was in the forefront of my mind, that, you know, small teams of individuals can make some great applications, make, you know, tens of thousands a month, and just never scale unless they get another one. And unless you can show me a way you can systematically develop successful applications over and over, you know, it's not enough.
But I thought there were entire venture funds, or at least parts of venture funds, that I fund. I mean, you guys get sort of carried away with the latest and greatest shiny toy. I know that, but
we're not all doing that. Some of those funds are being started by the vendors that have a proprietary interest in seeing the applications part of their ecosystem accelerate.
Rory, you had a cocked eyebrow over there.
Yeah, no, just listen.
I think that's just natural.
And if not, it's getting there now. It's just interesting to listen to the comments on, you know, the iPhone and whether or not you can build a company. Yeah, because the two comments that were said in some sense contradict each other. And I don't have the answer, but just point it out. The comment David made was a great one, which is this shift to a mobile platform as being a profound, you know, computing shift to a next generation platform. And then the comments that some of us, including me, made, which is, I don't know if I can build a if you can build a big company making iPhone apps. Well, back in 1982.
Apple. Oh,
Apple,
I think you can.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely.
Yes.
I absolutely disagree. I think there are opportunities for entrepreneurs to build.
Good. That's
build
where I'm going, because I think that you can't have a mobile, a new computing platform, and simultaneously not feel really excited about the opportunity to invest in companies building applications for that platform. I mean, very much like the discussion in 80-81 on, you know, is software a separate business from hardware? In retrospect, IBM called that one wrong. So I think if it really is a next generation real computing platform, then there absolutely will be more software companies. It's one of those areas where you got to keep an open mind, and your thinking could evolve.
Totally agree. I mean, I there's going to be great, huge applications that, you know, you pay plenty of money for. Yeah. And there'll be teams that can do that in a replicatable way, or there'll be underlying technologies that enable them to do that are investable. I'm talking about, you know, the popular 90-day game that, you know, comes and goes and is really pretty simple.
So you think we'll sort of see this Microsoft of the mobile platform, or, you know, could be the Apple of the mobile platform if it's not Apple already, but, you know, emerge fairly.
We're already seeing different platforms. You know, I mentioned Flurry from an analytics side. You're going to see different platforms emerging for how do you manage and interact with consumers directly, and not just with games, but social. You know, the social aspect of that, and networking and location and location services. There's a whole host of opportunities that obviously you wouldn't even think of necessarily with a laptop, because you don't walk around with your laptop all day long. That you can utilize here.
Let me ask you this: in this recession, have you seen the sort of profile of the entrepreneur change? Are you getting different kinds of people coming through your door, or is it all, you know, folks working, you know, at night after work or in their dorm room still? And are you seeing a shift in who wants to be an entrepreneur?
Well, they are always a hearty bunch, and they have to be. And I think that what's particularly gratifying is that you have entrepreneurs that are so committed and so passionate about their product or their idea or their concept, their project, that they will do what it takes, and they'll work the extra hours. They'll identify capital where capital doesn't exist, and they're the ones that move the mountains. And we are there as a resource to them, to help them along that path.
I know entrepreneurs are passionate, and or they should be, about what they're creating. One thing that they tend to enjoy, though, are selling their companies or going public and making a boatload of money. That's not something we've seen of late. Dixon, I'll ask you this. How do we unfreeze sort of exits, both on your behalf for the venture capital industry, but, you know, also for the entrepreneurs who are getting you guys the exits that you need?
Well, this is a very complicated and long answer question. I'll try to keep it fairly short. I did devote my entire year of my tenure as the NVCA chairman to figuring out some ways that we can help loosen up the liquidity in the capital markets environment. There are, you know, a couple of places people can go to get copies of the deliverable on the NVCA website or on the DCM website. We've got a little report here that there's no time to go into tonight of about 38 pages that go through the details. But what I would say is that you know, we examined the ecosystem, and we've come forth with a number of recommendations about getting more boutique banks back involved in the game again, about educating boards of directors and entrepreneurs to structure their boards from the very beginning, so that they have experience in consciously deciding to create the option to go public at some point in the future.
And boutique banks are there for lending purposes or
no boutique banks public? Because the
investment
banks. Okay. Sorry about that if I didn't make that clear.
People but to launch the IPO.
The gotcha. The you know in the last couple of years there was a flurry of activity back in the 80s and 90s that was initiated by four banks that were known as the Four Horsemen that specialized in taking young venture-backed companies public, right. And all of those were bought out by big banks in the late part of the mid to late part of the 90s, and so then we fell off the cliff with the nuclear winter after 9/11, and there were not a lot of IPOs, and so the banks themselves have been going through a number of major challenges, but certainly one of the things that happened is a mindset where if an entrepreneur and the board members couldn't get companies like or firms like Goldman Sachs and Morgan Stanley to take their companies public, they felt they had an ugly baby. And that's actually one of the myths that we sought to dispel in this this report. We think those are both great firms, but there's a number of other good big banks and intermediate tier banks and a number of boutiques that have been very very effective at taking emerging growth companies public for quite a long time. So we need to get that going again. There's a long list of recommendations, and I'll try to come back to a few more of them before we're done.
Okay, I just want to give our audience a chance. We're going to be taking your questions soon, so please start lining up at the mic, and we'll get to your questions. Jennifer.
So I just wanted to add one thing to the issue about liquidity and IPO, and I think it's really important for Americans to understand this issue, which is we've had a tremendous run with being IPOs and public markets being a U.S. centric marketplace. With NASDAQ and New York Stock Exchange, we dominate the globe in terms of marketable securities. The Chinese market is emerging, and there is an incredibly strong push by the Chinese government and other governments, frankly, in Europe as well, but particularly in China, to move their companies and to develop their own exchanges. And those will be powerhouse exchanges. And if we continue to make it difficult for companies to go public and to identify potential institutional investors here in the U.S., we're going to see more and more of our companies, both U.S.-based companies as well as other Chinese or South Korean companies, going public on other exchanges. And you will see the Beijing Exchange and the Shanghai Exchange continue to emerge as a global powerhouse. And that's something that policymakers need to be thinking very carefully about as we try and rebuild some of our financial systems.
I think all the institutional factors around, Sarbanes-Oxley and all the other discussions that Dixon had about getting companies public are definitely there and valid and definitely raise the bar. But fundamentally, I think exits will come back when risk appetite comes back. Because, there's been two IPOs, there's a long drought with no IPOs in the venture business, and then there was two IPOs recently. And what you saw is almost immediately when the market stabilized and investors and Fidelity and T. Rowe Price and Vanguard and all these larger firms start feeling, frankly, more like taking on risk. At that point, high-growth companies will be able to get public.
There actually have been as many venture-backed IPOs this year as there were all of last
yes.
year, and we're not even at the midpoint
right.
of the year
which
yet.
Is, and given,
which is not saying much.
Eight is not a big number.
Yeah. But,
yes. It
but
doesn't divide
the appetite
well into 200.
For risk has clearly increased significantly in the last couple of months. And you're absolutely
and
right.
To be
that's
clear,
gotta be there.
And to be clear, it's not just risk, it's growth. So what they're investing is they are taking a higher risk investment in these companies, but they're looking for growth. They're looking for businesses
growth,
that are growing quickly.
Well, seeking growth is
yes,
risk.
Yes, of course. They're seeking growth, but
understood,
taking on
but,
risk.
But just to be clear, it's not risk for risk's sake. It's because these are high growth companies with the potential capacity to develop.
I think we can stipulate that there's no one attempting to take on risk for risk's sake, because those people kind of blew up in late 07.
They are gone.
they are gone.
Let's move to some questions from our audience. As a reminder, this program is presented by the Commonwealth Club's INFORUM, and tonight we're hosting Hey VCs, Can You Spare a Dime? Or how about a roll of nickels? I'm Michael Copeland, moderator for the evening, and we're here in discussion with Mike Buckley, Managing Director, Intel Capital, Dixon Dahl, co-founder and general partner, DCM, Jennifer Fonstad, Managing Director, Draper Fisher Jurvetson, Dave Tennenhouse, Partner, New Venture Partners, and Rory O'Driscoll, Managing Director, Scale Venture Partners. Now let's go to some questions. You, sir.
Hi, I'm Rob Poor. First, I want to say it's nice to see so many familiar faces on the board. I want to ask a question about innovation, but perhaps not the way you're thinking of it. Angel investors are doing larger deals. Private equity firms are coming in earlier in the lifetime of a company. The standard exits for a VC firm really aren't available in the same with the same ease that they used to be. So as a VC, how do you innovate your own model to be relevant in all of these circumstances? Thank you.
I'll take a crack at that, and I alluded to it at the beginning, and that is that we have to change all the time. And that means I disagree that the private equity firms are, you know, being as active and coming down into our business as they were a couple of years ago. They have their own set of challenges right now, but that doesn't make it the liquidity environment any better. So I just think we have to be creative. We have to think about ways to raise money for our companies and do M&A transactions in other geographies like Japan and China and India and in Europe. You know, there's going to be a dramatic explosion in international liquidity events, both the public offerings that Jennifer referred to, which I completely and totally agree with, as well as in M&A. M&A is going to happen in countries and with companies where the money is, and where's the money these days? And there's not been a lot of that yet, but mark my words, you're going to see a lot more M&A coming from some of the countries like China and Japan as we go forward, because that's where the cash is. It's not commonly known, but Japan does more trade with China than the U.S. does. So there's a tremendous amount of activity here that if we just take a U.S.-centric view, we're going to miss out what's really going on.
Next question.
I was looking at Kleiner's investments the other day, and I saw that I think there was one company that where they weren't investing in a proprietary technology, but they were investing in the business model. It was a recycle bank. Is that pretty standard across the industry, that sort of breakdown where, you know, 99% of the companies that you're investing in, you're investing in a technology as opposed to an innovative business model?
I don't think we look at the world quite that way, because we're very much looking at individual opportunities. Certainly in our portfolio, if you looked at DFJ's portfolio, you would have seen that we have a number of companies that are growing significantly, like SolarCity, which some of you may be familiar with, which is a services-based model which installs solar panels to primarily residences and small businesses around California and increasingly across the U.S. That is just one example of many, but you really have to remember we're looking at opportunities on a very case-specific and project-specific basis, yeah. And so it's hard to make those generalizations by looking through a portfolio.
So I think
go ahead, David.
I mean, I actually think the best ventures combine usually multiple innovations, and it's typically one technical and one business model innovation. You know, and so, in fact, I'd say most of our ventures have a significant business model innovation simply because, you know, in the technology world, most things have been tried before. Right, so we always think that it's really, you know, great new technology, totally innovative, but usually it's been tried before by somebody, and the question that, you know, you're always asking is, why will this work this time? And that usually means there's some business model innovation, something's, you know, now occasionally it's something's changed in the ecosystem and you don't have to do a new business model innovation and life is so much simpler, and that's great. But I'd actually say the vast bulk of the investments have a component of business model innovation, and if they don't, our mission is to help them get one, because they're otherwise not going to be successful.
Yeah, I think that's true. I think Tesla Motors, which is one of our investments, which some of you may be familiar with as well, is very much an innovation both on the technical side and in the battery space specifically, as well as in the business model, which is trying not to mimic the old dealership model that brought down the Detroit 3. Yeah.
I'd broadly concur and say, you know, it does vary by deal type. I mean, you cited Kleiner. I would say Amazon is one of their shining successes. They sell books. People had thought of that already, but they just did it slightly differently. And I think, you know, that was heavy business model component. And, you know, modest, some technology advantage, but primarily business model driven. There's equally other successes that are, you know, 90% plus IP. I mean, many biotech companies, the business model is pretty
successful. Intellectual property into the equation. You can't just look at technology and business model. Intellectual property has to be a part of that.
I mean, for me, I think, I mean, what we're looking for is some sort of sustainable competitive advantage. Yep. I mean, I hate to use it, it's kind of an overused terminology, but sometimes that doesn't exist. If it's just business model alone, someone else can come in and do it quicker, bigger, faster. So, you know, that's the thing that I think just makes that that differentiator alone hard.
I think that term is overused. I mean, I look for sustainable lead, which
right,
is
unless
a little different.
I was
gonna say. How big is your lead? I mean, that's partly because with our spinouts, we're hoping that they come with the lead. And the question to me is, okay, how big is your lead and how sustainable is your lead? I'm not really expecting, you know, that sustainable.
And one of the things that we've been discussing, you guys can help people keep that lead by, you know, keeping the thing cranking, right?
I mean, I think Amazon's a great example of that. Because the business model innovation wasn't just selling things on the web. Having the guts to keep spending in 01 and 02 when everyone was sneering and saying, you got to get the cash flow break even, you're a fool, you're crazy, you only need 3 distribution centers, I'll build 7. But you put up now, there has been very few other web retailers who made it. And none of them at the scale that Amazon made it. And it was a lead. It was a willingness to, it was very business model centric, but the innovation was the realization that once you got those customers, you got them forever. So do what it takes to get them.
No,
but we should point out that did Mr. Bezos take a whole lot of venture capital?
He took a whole lot of venture capital, then a whole lot of public capital, then a whole lot of public debt, and he kept taking it and spending it.
Yeah.
But they got it all back. It's funny, I remember in 2002, there was 3 or 4 investment banks who wrote pretty tough reports saying that Amazon was going to be bankrupt on their bonds. Subsequently, all those investment banks are bankrupt on their bonds. Funny the way things turn out.
Let's take another question.
I have a consumer products company. I'm in the process of raising Series A funding, and I hope that I never have to raise any more funding based on my current experience. But in the event that I do and go to the next round, what mistakes or pitfalls do you see entrepreneurs make on Series A term sheets that make it difficult for you to do deals with them at Series B level? Assuming everything is a fit, that the company would be an appropriate investment.
I'll take a stab at that. I think that you have to, when you're looking at your term sheet details, you have to think past the first round. You have to think through 3-4 rounds. And you cannot let the terms get out ahead of the company's headlights. So you have to think like a venture capitalist. You have to understand the way they're going to analyze it, and which is, are you going to be able to get a step up? What kind of progress are you going to make with the company on the Series A that you raise? And will you be at a point in time where, if you're successful, the fundamentals of the business will justify raising money for the Series B at an appropriate step up? So
let me just
planning
clarify,
all the way through.
Just for those people who are not raising funds, that a Series A is your sort of first big round of institutional venture capital, followed by your Series B, which is your next big round of institutional venture capital.
I think one of the things, and this sort of came up before in terms of what's changed, is it varies by sector, but in most sectors, I think the goalposts for the Series B have changed. And I don't think that that's fully internalized by everybody, including us in the venture community. So, you know, at some level, what it says to me is, depending on, you know, how much capital you may need and the particular sector, you want to get a Series A syndicate that's deep enough that if you have to take this further downstream to raise Series B money than was originally anticipated, not because you were missing your targets, but because you were achieving your targets, but the Series B investors want to see more before they're going to come in at a decent valuation. So you've got to make sure that syndicate's deep enough that it's going to be able to internally go ahead and say, okay, we'll raise the money internally, you know, whether it's, you know, it's by bridging or insider round. We all hate insider rounds, but we're deep enough and we'll do it to get this to the point where the Bs are going to come in. Because that, I think, is a really big change. And it does vary by sector, but I think those goalposts have moved, and I don't think they're going to move back very soon.
Thank you.
Next question.
So it's a twofold question. Number one, is it still possible to develop a successful tech company in a garage or a small lab? And the other side of the question is, how does one ascertain when it's time for VC?
I think it's more possible now than ever to you know, start a startup or start a company in a garage. You know, the web and iPhones and, you know, there's a bunch of opportunities for low capital, you know, startups to get scale. And get consumer adoption pretty easily and quickly. So yeah, I think it's easier now than ever.
Can we be more specific? Like, what are the ingredients there that make it that way?
I mean, there's a lot of open source software available. There's, you know, you can program just from one guy on a PC. It's, I think, actually easier than semiconductor, where you actually had to have some equipment and some materials and some clean room, and which was where a lot of the venture 10 years ago, 15 years ago was happening. So I think a lot of the software opportunities really, I think, lowers the bar from a capital consumption perspective.
By the way, there's plenty of money out there today. It's been raised. There's a large pool of capital that's available, but our venture firms, as you probably know, are being extremely cautious these days. And but the ones of us that have been around for a long time know that history shows us that some of the very best real companies that have ever been created got started in recessionary environments like we're in right now, when you can put great teams of people together, you can raise money from firms like those of us up here that have a long view of the world and understand that now is a good time to do that, because there's no short-term revenue pressures, but it's just to focus on building the product or the service and then worrying about generating revenue a couple, 3 years from now, when hopefully the economy is going to be better.
But
so.
I want to answer your second question, which is when do you go to a venture capitalist? And you really want to take the business as far as you can, in the sense that you want to be able to have proof points to demonstrate either the technology works, that you're solving a real customer problem, that customers care about the problem, that it's a market that is growing quickly, or that you can grow in that marketplace sufficiently fast and to sufficiently large size. And typically we're talking about billion-dollar markets that you would potentially be playing in. You want to be able to potentially have a customer or partner that you could be working with. You may be able to get access to government, and I won't say stimulus dollars, because there have been traditional government programs out there to help catalyze and start new technologies through DARPA programs and SBIRs and a whole host of other opportunities for getting early capital in to catalyze your business. But you want to push the business as far as you can and have as many proof points around your market, the problem you're solving, and your technology in order to attract entrepreneurial investment, venture investment.
I think, by the way, on there, that the potential to outsource is a big change. You were talking about it for software, but I mean, if you want to get prototypes done or anything like that, you can get stuff turned around really cheap, really fast, and be out there. And the good news is you don't need your whole garage, because here in California, everybody's garage is full of stuff. So, fortunately, you don't even need a garage.
Could be a closet. Next question, please.
I don't know very much about VC, but I was wondering, is there examples of, or do VCs ever fund companies where their focus isn't like a profit or how big this can be? Or something more like a charity or anything like that that's focuses new ideas rather than new technology, something like that?
I think what VCs might do as people, as individuals, might well do that. But the reality is we have money on a fiduciary relationship from a bunch of LPs who are pension funds, fund of funds, insurance companies who are looking for a return. So the majority of our business investing endeavors are to generate a capital gain for our LPs, and by virtue of that, for ourselves.
Is there no examples of that at all?
I mean, I think that some this would not be my core competence. I will say I think some companies in the Valley, I don't know if any VCs do, but some companies make charitable giving a key part of what they do as business, and I think it's quite admirable. I know Salesforce does, I think, 1% of their net income, 1% of the company, and 1% of employees' time. I know Google does something similar. I think it is a good unifying thing to build a corporate culture. I actually don't know, I mean, I know VCs as GPs and individuals for the firm might do it, but actively, in other words, say, as a group of GPs pursuing some charitable activity as a group, may well, it happens quite a lot, but to actively take some of your limited partners' money that they've entrusted to you and invest it in something that's not going to make them a return, that's just not the way the game is played.
There's a non-profit VC fund.
Legacy Ventures is an example, and they go out and invest in for-profit venture firms, but they take all the profits that they generate from those investments and give them back to charity.
in the interest of completeness, there are many 2,000 nonprofit venture firms. They just didn't. They just were not aware of it at the time they started.
Good point. Next
question. The other thing I'll just add.
Sorry.
I want to add one thing that, and that is that I think all of our goals up here, and I know this is Andy Grove's goal when he started Intel, and a lot of our goals when we fund some of these companies is really to build companies that can make a difference and drive innovation, change people's lives. One example that sort of might fit into that paradigm is eBay. I mean, look at how many people eBay employs, and what a great utility that is. And so we are looking for things that change the world, better people's lives. A lot of the clean tech and those, hopefully we'll do that as well. So, that's for profit, but we are trying to make a difference through innovation.
And to be fair, a lot of the sort of technology innovations and business models that you guys fund are brought to bear on, nonprofit and charity and sort of social responsible businesses or problems around the world. Next question, please.
Yes, my question is, if you have someone that comes to you with an idea and you don't think that it's right for your particular company at that time, do you match, but you still think that the idea is a good one and it's profitable in some way, would you match them with another company, such as Apple or another?
Yeah, that's
group?
A good question. I mean, if you guys invest in, let's just say, semiconductors or, health science, and somebody doesn't do their homework and comes to you and pitches you an idea that maybe isn't a great fit for you, what happens next?
We do referrals.
Yeah, we do our best to point people that are not a good fit for us in the right direction if we know other friends and other firms that we think can help.
It's got to be a good enough idea that it's not going to hurt my reputation with a colleague that I'm wasting their time and passing them something that's garbage. But, for us, particularly since we only invest in spinoffs, a lot of people come to us with non-spinoffs. We'll pass them along. There's a lot of VCs in the Valley that don't want to do spinoffs, and some of our best projects come to us by referral from VCs that like the idea, but they just don't want to do a spinoff.
But the flip side, too, is that if I'm an entrepreneur approaching you, I better have a pretty good sense of what you guys like to invest in.
It's good to try and do that research.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of information about each of our firms today or on the Internet and through other sources, so there's certainly
some of which are accurate and some of which are not.
Some of which are accurate, a lot of which is not correct. But certainly you can identify areas of interest, areas of investment, look at past portfolio companies. There's some basic fundamentals that you can identify to help find the right folks to work with.
The second best answer we can give, other than yes, we want to invest, is no quickly. and I think usually what I try to do is give some feedback. If it's totally not a fit, I try to give some input on where they should go, and if it is potentially a fit, sort of, but not now, what kind of things I'd like to see before it is interesting again.
And a tip, if someone if they see in a meeting, and I've done it, he turns you down on the spot and says, this is just not interesting for us, one of the worst things you can do is try and get into the argument, because he actually is being really nice, because having fundraised myself, there's nothing worse than the long silence, and in fact telling you right there in the meeting, this is not something we do, or I don't even believe this will ever work because of A, B, and C, it's actually a real favor. Take the data, doesn't cost you anything.
I haven't met that many that appreciate the favor, though.
I had one turn down in my fundraiser, and I just loved that the guy 40 minutes in said, let me tell you what I'm going to do. I'm not going to do this. And I was like, thank you.
Let's go to our last question.
Just a quick question. I'm curious about what you're seeing out of your pipeline or recent companies that you funded. Are you seeing, what's the breakdown between a first-time startup CEO and a second- and third-time startup CEO? And out of the first-time startup CEOs, where are they coming from? Are they the young 20-something, or are they the seasoned entrepreneur?
Well, we certainly believe in investing in the young entrepreneur. There's just such an incredible track record of the 20-something entrepreneur who has successfully built a business from Bill Gates, through the eBay team, through the Facebook and Google guys, and there's just so many folks that have been able to demonstrate that they don't know what they don't know, and they take it. I can take on the world attitude, which is just which is refreshing and which can fundamentally change the world sometimes. And so we welcome the opportunity to invest in younger teams and younger entrepreneurs.
I keep coming back to that question that we got earlier about, you know, is the type of entrepreneur changed in this environment that you're seeing? And I think, you know, in one way, I think it has. I mean, I don't think I'm seeing the gold rush, get rich quick kind as much. And I'm seeing more of the, you know, and or no fewer of the really committed, you know, folks that want to create disruptive innovation. And that can come in all forms, you know. Young,
it doesn't imply young teams. It doesn't imply age or
right,
experience.
It
on the other hand, there may be someone that is older than 20-something that is incredibly passionate and has a lot of experience in a particular space, and they want to change the world and waste municipal waste, and they're going
to
do it.
I cling to the hope that 31-year-olds or older can do something too.
I on that note, I want to let's give a big hand for our panelists and thank them very much. This meeting of INFORUM and the Commonwealth Club is now adjourned.